Hey there, Lindsay here, the Frugal Crafter. Today we're going to do this sketch together. Well, I did this sketch the other day, and I'm going to show you the process here for Sketchbook Sunday, and I'm working in my 8.5 by 8.5 inch Arteza watercolor sketchbook. This is kind of what do I want to call it? It's a little bit of a surprising sketchbook, because sometimes the paper's really consistent, and then all of a sudden you'll get like a paper with like no sizing on it, or a very small amount of sizing, and that's the sheet of paper that I came upon today. It's like you never know what you're going to get. It's like, Arteza sketchbooks are like a box of chocolates for all that. I mean, most of the time the pages are fine, but every once in a while you get one with some wonky sizing, and that's what happened today. I'm starting off with a call erase pencil. I'm using like, I don't know what they call it exactly. It's like a dark blue, and, I'm actually not sure why I'm using this dark blue, but I figured, what the heck, you know? I think because I wanted to put a blue feather in here, so I figured, well, I'm going to do blue ink and a blue feather. Might as well have the drawing in blue. Now, the color erase pencils are nice because they're not so waxy that watercolor won't stick to them, and they're also not so waxy that if you want to use alcohol markers, which I would not recommend in this book, I've tried that on this paper, and it's really, it just sucks the marker dry. It's very uncomfortable to use that, but this works great for watercolors and watercolor markers and gouache and things like that. But anyway, I love the color erase pencils. They're not very expensive. I think you can get a box of like 12 assorted colors for $6, or a box of 24 for like, you know, $12. And it's just nice because you can use multiple colors if you want to. I usually just grab one color that I think will be mostly hidden once I get my painting done. And for whatever reason, I think because sketching with a colored lead versus a graphite, well, for one, it doesn't smear like graphite. If you ever have issues with, maybe you rest your hand on your paper, or you rub across the paper with your hand on when you don't mean to, and you end up with smears, you don't get the smears with this. And it's just, it doesn't harm your alcohol markers to go over it because it's not waxy enough, and it doesn't make your watercolor bead up because it's not waxy enough. So anyway, I really like it. And I think sometimes just not having graphite as your underdrawing can break you out of a little bit of an art block. If you've been stumped or if you've been frustrated, just having a different color lead can do some wonderful things. And I've seen other artists actually recommend using a non-photo blue pencil. And there is a really like pale turquoise color that's in the 12. Oh, it's in the 24 set. I'm not sure if that's a non-photo blue pencil or if you have to buy that one separately and it's not in the set. But, you know, regardless, most of these colors just kind of fade into the ether once you've gotten your painting done. So I'm starting off by wetting the background, and I'm using my Lucas watercolors here. And I like to use my Lucas watercolors whenever I am going to be doing something with skin tones or portraits, because they just work so well for portraits. They're so easy to control. If you're layering on a face or a body, they're just wonderful for that. And since I have a hand, which is going to be the most difficult part of this picture to paint, I wanted to just go with something that was tried and true. Now, this set of Lucas paints has 24 colors, and it's part of my signature set through Jerry's Artorama. And with that set, you also get the brushes that I'm using here, which are the Mimic. They're faux fur. They're meant to mimic squirrel brushes, so they're very absorbent. They come to a nice sharp point. They hold tons of water and paint, and they're fantastic. So the paints, those brushes, and a block of Fabriano Artistico watercolor paper comes with that. And it's really nice. I also really like Arches watercolor paper. Those are cotton watercolor papers. I don't tend to use them for sketchbook work because they're a little more expensive. I kind of save them for final paintings. But you will definitely have an easier time to blend, and you won't have any feathering if you were to use that. And we had some issues here, as you'll see in this painting. And I'll link to everything I used in the video description, but the best supplies that you can use in your projects are the ones you already have. So if you already have watercolors, you already have watercolor paper or a sketchbook, go for it. Use what you have. Now, of course, a drawing sketchbook might not hold up to your watercolors. Some drawing paper holds up great to a light wash, and other ones just pill and don't hold up. Oddly enough, like Blick Studio, like this, their classroom grade white sulfite paper holds a light wash really well. No, it's not an acid-free paper though, so I wouldn't recommend doing it on something you want to last for years and years, but for practice, it actually takes a light wash really well. And I use it a lot in my, like free kids classes I would do at the library, because, you know, we could burn through it and it wasn't very expensive, and the kids didn't lose any of their, you know, they didn't lose the joy of painting on it. They got the results. We got the results we needed, and it was a very cost-effective measure. So definitely something to consider if you're a teacher, or if you just, if the paper is just so precious that you don't even want to use it. Now, I wouldn't recommend it for serious watercolor work, but it would definitely do light washes that you intend to finish up with, like color pencils or pastel pencils or something like that on top, because it's only 90 pound. It's not like super heavy or anything. I think it's 90 pound. I think they actually have a couple different weights you can get of that. But anyway, this is a watercolor sketchbook I'm working in here. It's not a very expensive one. It's not the highest quality one, but for whatever reason, I'm used to this paper and I enjoy it. Now, one thing you can do to avoid feathering if you're getting that in your painting is to dry your paper. Now, it's really humid in Maine this time of year, and if you live in an area that's really humid, you may need to pull out a hairdryer or get out a heat tool. It doesn't matter. Either will work just as well. And really wick all that moisture out of your paper, or you will have that those rough, feathery edges that that can be really aggravating. And it only takes like, I don't know, 10, 15, 20 seconds with a hairdryer or a heat tool to whisk away that moisture and make those lines appear much crisper. But still, if you're working on a paper that doesn't have great sizing and you add a lot of water, you do like a really light watery mix, you can still get some feathering. So just kind of keep that in mind. I don't mind in a sketchbook having some weird pages. You know, I kind of roll with it. I think it's kind of part of the fun of doing sketchbook work, where it's not precious. I'm not going to sell it. It's just in the book for, you know, me to enjoy flipping through later. You know, I definitely want a more reliable, consistent paper when I'm doing a final painting. And there, can you see? I mean, my paper was a little damp from that first brown wash, but I thought it was dry enough, but I really got a lot of feathering on that. I was going to just do a couple little drops of, actually, I think I was going to do a shadow, and then it looked like it was way too dark and it was kind of a mess. But actually, that was probably more my fault than the paper there. So the theme for this day for World Watercolor Month, and that's what this is, I did this for, was, tickle. And I thought, well, a feather, you can tickle somebody with a feather, but you could also tell a joke and tickle someone's funny bone. So that's why I have this this old bard writing a knock-knock joke with a feather quill. I thought it was kind of funny. And, you know, he's got this juggling equipment in the background because he's a professional and he's got all his stuff there. So I don't know. I think most everyone got the theme and how I worked the prompt in. Now I'm getting some feathering here, and I actually did dry the background, so I was really bummed out about it. And then the hand it's bleeding of the hand. I think I like forgot that I didn't dry the hand, and it was just kind of going out of control. And sometimes I've noticed with this paper, and you know, hey, I like the paper. I know it probably sounds like I'm saying don't buy this paper. I actually like this paper, but every once in a while you get either a badly sized sheet, or you will get like a page where there's like, it's fine except for like, there'll be a stripe where there's like no sizing. It's like, what the heck is going on? That happened in a goldfish drawing I did a few months ago that's on my YouTube channel. I think that was also a Sketchbook Sunday one. And it was fine because it was mostly colored pencil and I was just putting a background wash in, but it was kind of like, yikes, I had this whole like band of darker color, which I managed to work in, but still it was kind of like a yee, because it was at the end of the painting. But anyway, you can see how the feather is looking really feathered, and that's not the effect I was going for. Now, I think it's important to mention that even if your supplies are not working the way you're expecting, you don't have to trash the painting. Now, you can if you're really frustrated and you don't think you're getting anything out of the work, and you're frustrated and you're just not enjoying it. You can let it go and not finish a painting, not finish a sketch. But you can also develop a lot of problem solving and troubleshooting skills if you do push through and keep on working. So I decided, well, and also doing the World Watercolor Month Challenge, I honestly don't have extra time to redo a painting. So it's like, I'm just going to make this work because this is all I have time to do today. So I decided that I would keep pushing through it. So one way I knew I could avoid the feathering on this paper is to use my paint thicker. I didn't want a darker paint though. So, I used the white paint in this set to mix a kind of a creamy skin tone highlight color. Kind of think like, well, if you've ever seen foundation, like if you either wear foundation makeup or you've seen it in a story, you know how it's like very opaque and very, very pale in a lot of cases. A lot of times women will use a lighter tone and they'll put it on their face to kind of like even things out. Well, that's what I would do here. So I used white into the normal skin tone mix I would dilute with water, and I added white instead of diluting it with water, and was able to build up some of the the body and richness and lighten areas up where my paint just kind of seeped into the paper too much and went a little dark. And then again, drying that paper so that I could avoid any more feathering if I went over it. Now here I'm using some colored pencils, and I'm actually using those Brute Fooner, the set of 520 that I reviewed recently on my channel. And these actually worked really good on this paper over watercolor, especially because they would hold a really sharp point. So I know I was a bit critical of those pencils, and I stand by my review, but I have to say for this, they worked really well. And it's funny because sometimes budget supplies work with budget supplies. And sometimes using cheaper paints work better on cheaper paper. Like a lot of the brands of watercolor that are out of China and Korea, they have more like body to them and they're not as flowy. But when you use them on an unsized paper, because a lot of times they're developed to work on rice paper, they don't feather and they give you a really good result. Of course, I was using a German watercolor brand with this Lucas from Germany, so they're more of a traditional watercolor and they were feathering like crazy. But these pencils also work really good on this paper, which is a more affordable paper. I did use a Prismacolor here for my white just because I had one handy, and it's really, you can't beat a Prismacolor white. And I was really happy with how that feather came out, and I was really enjoying working with the pencils on this paper. So I would say if you have the Brute Fooner round pencils with the colored barrels, try them on the Arteza paper if you have that. It's a very... it's almost hot press. It's not as slick as like an Arches hot press, but it's very similar to a Paul Rubens hot press, but it's not cotton. It's just a wood pulp, but it does work really well with your budget color pencils, especially if they're a little bit on the firmer side. It just, it's just a really good match. And, I think that's kind of half the battle, finding what paper works with what medium, or finding what canvas works with what medium. And the only way to do that is to just keep an open mind and experiment, and don't be afraid to, you know, ruin something, especially in a sketchbook, because sketchbooks should be full of joyful practice. And I mean, hey, I have days. I had a day the other day, and if you go to my Instagram, you would have seen it. It was I painted a teacup on a stack of books, and I was so frustrated, and it was late. I had put off doing the challenge until late, almost bedtime, and I was tired, and I was frustrated, and it wasn't going the way I wanted, and I was embarrassed by my attempt. But it's like, well, I'm going to post it because I have signed up for this challenge. Not that there's anywhere to sign up. I haven't, you know, I'm just doing it, and I'm very kind of like, I don't know. I get obsessed. What if I'm going to do something, I'm going to do it, or I'm not going to do it. There's no in between for me. It's either I do it or I don't do it. And so I'm like, I'm posting something. There is no, there's no not posting if I've decided to do a challenge. And yeah, I was very, I didn't even want to check my comments afterwards. I didn't want to, like, I would just, was so done with it. But other than that, generally working on a sketchbook should feel very freeing, and you should use it as an excuse to play and experiment and not worry about how it comes out, because nobody has to see it if you don't want them to. I mean, I didn't have to post that, but I didn't want to not post something, and I didn't have time to do something else. So so that's how that went down. And it's usually times when I'm feeling rushed, when I'm like, I don't have enough time, that I end up getting frustrated with my work. Now, I think it is good to have a little bit of a time limit, because I think we're creative in constraints. So if you say, I got all day to do this painting, you probably won't start it until like the last possible minute. I mean, at least that's me. But if I say, okay, I'm going to work on this for 25 minutes, I'll get right to work because I only have 25 minutes, you know, versus like, oh, I could start it at 10 o'clock. And if I'm still working at midnight, oh, well, you know, there's still time there, but you know, it's no good if I'm cranky and tired. So just kind of keep that in mind and try to keep your sketchbook work as joyful and as non, judgmental and as non high stakes as you can, so that, you know, you enjoy it and you can grow. Because if you're feeling like you have to perform every time you open up your sketchbook to do a drawing, it's not going to be fun, and it's going to be constrictive, and you're not going to take risks because somebody's going to see them, and you might be embarrassed. You take risks in your sketchbook. That's what it's for. Those pencils there, they're still the Brute Fooners. Actually having quite a ball working on this paper with them. So I would honestly say, if you're going to go splash out and get that 520 set of Brute Fooners, I would highly recommend this Arteza watercolor sketchbook, because that works so well. They just pair really well. And I think you would really enjoy using them together. It has just enough texture to grab the pencil lead really well, but it's not so smooth that you can't get enough down. And I really love using those paler pastel, like, pencil tones, especially to do flesh tones, because then you can get that creamy effect. Now, obviously, if you're a painting darker skin, you would still you'd still want to use almost some tones lighter than what you think you should use, and then you can blend that in with a darker skin tone, and that's how you get that rich, creamy, smooth effect. So, you know, it just looks like the smooth texture of skin. I hope that makes sense. So it's nice to have a good range of earth tones so you can capture whatever, you know, whatever you want to, especially if you're a portrait painter. And having like purples, and I'm not suggesting you go and buy a 500 pencil set. I mean, 520 pencils is insane. I'm not suggesting that. I actually would suggest that you pick up a smaller set of a legacy brand so you can replace the colors as you need to, like Prismacolor. I order whites, indigos, and terracotta, you know, like they're going out of style because I use them up before other colors. And it's nice to have, have a set you can do that with, because then you don't have to rebuy a set or have to find a match in another company. But then again, if you do start off with a budget line and you use up the Crimson Lake, for instance, you can find a pretty good match in like Prismacolor or Colorsoft or something like that that would be a similar feeling, or find exactly the pencil you want and the color you want, and then you can build your artist pencil collection slowly that way. So there's a lot of different ways to do it. Everybody has a different preference, and you should do whatever makes sense to you. Now, one of the reasons I'll go over with the heat gun towards the end is so I can remove my tape easily. Now, the Arteza sketchbook will rip if you do not, if you use masking tape and you do not preheat it. Washi tape might do all right, but I still will heat it with a heat tool and pull it away at an angle because it does tend to rip even when I do that sometimes. And it is because this is not a superly duperly sized paper. It's definitely on the light side with sizing. So just kind of keep that in mind and use a hairdryer or a heat tool or I don't know, something where you can get some warmth on that paper, set it in the sun, I don't know, something to warm it up. I still tore the paper a little bit. Can you see that there? That's really going to help you make sure you get those nice borders. And I think it just makes the picture look finished. But anyway, there you have it. I hope you enjoyed this process video on how I did one of these World Watercolor Month drawings. And thanks so much for watching. Till next time, happy crafting. Bye-bye.